The iPad Pro 13-inch with the new M4 chip is on our teardown table, and it's thinner than ever. But what's truly remarkable about this device is something that Apple didn't even mention during their event. There's a change in here that is going to save you hours on repair times. More on that in a minute. Apple doesn't publish repair guides for their tablets yet, so we're going in blind here. To see more than magnets and speaker placements, we have to bring in the big guns. Thankfully, our friends over at Creative Electron sent over some X-ray images so we can get an idea of what to expect. There are no screws on the exterior of these iPads, so the only way in is through the glued-in screen. I'm throwing it on the heat mat to warm up the display and loosen the glue. My buddy Clampy comes in handy here, doing the heavy lifting and creating a gap for my pick. The adhesive feels easy to cut through, but I did notice the device dissipated heat quickly. Good thermal management, I guess. Tilting the screen slightly gives me access to the screw and bracket holding the front-facing microphone cable, and then lifting the display up gives me access to the bracket and cables holding the screen in place. Four connectors in total. I guess tandem OLED means double the panel connectors. With the screen out the way, we can get our first good look at the interior of the new iPad Pro. Before we move on to the insides, let's take a closer look at that new tandem OLED, aka Ultra Retina panel. This beautiful screen is made possible by an OLED layering process that passes light through multiple electroluminescence layers. It's not quite the image of two panels on top of each other, but the idea is similar. OLEDs don't have a backlight, so brightness has always been an issue. By adding multiple luminescence layers, this OLED panel can achieve better peak brightness and color saturation. A big thanks to Evident Scientific for loaning us the gear to see this up close. The central bracket sitting on the logic board that we're unscrewing here is supposedly there to provide additional rigidity to the ridiculously thin frame. And underneath that is... the same thing? What we're most interested in now is how to disconnect the battery. There are two components to this, a bracket securing the cable connecting the two battery cells and the battery press connector found nearby. With the battery disconnected, I now need to figure out how to remove the two battery cells. The antenna assembly comes out first. Pull tabs are great to have, but they're pretty useless if you can't get to them. It's the same story further up. I tried to remove the camera assembly only to find a board underneath and an aluminum lip blocking access to the pull tabs. It's a bit annoying to have to do this to get to the only truly consumable part in this device. Starting on the left side, where I have easy access, I can remove the four larger pull tabs on this cell, followed by the four slightly harder to reach pull tabs on the opposite side. These itty bitty pull tabs at the bottom were easy and fun though. They're holding the power management boards for each of the cells in place, and they can make the iPad Pro magically recenter itself. Alright, so despite the hassle of getting to those pull tabs, the fact that you can remove the battery without having to remove every major component inside this device is still a huge win for repairability. It's a massive improvement over the previous generations. The battery itself comes in at 38.99 watt hours, which is slightly smaller than the 6th generation 40.33 watt hours. So what's left? We've got the daughter board that the camera connects to on the right hand side. That's screwed in and glued in, and a bigger pain to remove than it needs to be, purely because of the glue. We'll have a full chip ID published on our site in a few days if you're curious to see what's on there. To release the main board, we need to undo some coax cables that are glued down, some press connectors, more coax cables, and some more press connectors. Oh, and the board is glued down too. Going size zero on these devices has consequences, folks. The heart of this device is the new M4 chip, which is manufactured using TSMC's improved N3E 3nm node process. That means improved performance and more efficient power consumption. Both are high on the list of technologies that have allowed Apple to put a smaller battery inside this device. Apple moved the front-facing cameras from the portrait view to the landscape view, so no more off-center video calls when you're on FaceTime. But to do that, they had to sacrifice the inductive charging coil that was also on this side on the iPad 10. That's not the case with the new iPads. Underneath the camera, we can see the inductive charging mechanism alive and well. Placing our torn down Apple Pencil Pro shows where the wireless charging coils line up with the iPad's wireless charging mechanism. Hold up though, let's rewind and take a look at that new Apple Pencil. First up, let's take a moment to admire the beautiful calligraphy on the box. I'm a big fan of the box art on this thing. We'll start by removing the nib of the pencil. This is a disposable part, as is the pencil itself when the battery dies. And our teardown is done. Yet, no, I'm not a fan of spending $130 on disposable electronics, so I want to see that battery before I can end this teardown. Maybe, just maybe, if I slice the eraser off the top... Nope, no bueno. Time to get the ultrasonic cutter out again. let me introduce you to the world's worst ASMR video. I've got to say, this is the least destructive entry we've seen of any Apple Pencil. Maybe there's hope for getting to that battery yet. Check out that Taptic engine mounted right underneath the antenna. We can also see one of two sets of magnets next to the inductive charging coil mounted on the center of the Pencil Pro. Some careful digging lets me disconnect the Taptic engine from the rest of the Pencil. The Taptic engine is micro-welded to the body, so I'm gonna have to break those weld points. It's the same story with the inductive charge coil. It sits on a tray that's been welded to the frame. Removing the charge coil lets me snap those weld points without damaging the circuits. What looks like a pressure gauge sensor wraps around the lower half of the Pencil Pro and peels away easily enough. There's no button under all this. That click you feel is a function of the finely tuned Taptic engine. There is a panel underneath here though, and again, it's micro-welded. I'm hoping my entry point is under here. Peeling the panel away reveals another set of magnets and f*** me, damn it. Torn down by the teardown device, touche. Where was I? Ah yes, planning the imminent demise of my arch nemesis. Let's get these magnets out the way to see if there's a screw under there. No luck, but there's a sticker covering access to another connector. And look at that, there's that screw I was looking for. This press connector seems to lead to the nib of the Pencil. And I'm finally out of time and patience. I'm gonna have to start cutting to release things. There's a screw hiding at the top of the PCB just under the battery, and believe it or not, there's a screw hiding under this IC too. What I thought was a flex PCB glued to the board turned out to be soldered on. And there it is, the most ridiculous placement of a screw I've seen yet. Finally, that board is free. We'll have a full chip ID up on our website soon, so be sure to check it out if you want to see the MEM sensor that enables the new barrel roll feature. The last thing to come away is the first thing I was looking for, the battery. I think it's safe to say that this Pencil Pro isn't going back together. It might be an improvement over the first gen Pencil that was epoxied in, but this is still an unrepairable pile of e-waste. Apple's come a long way with the iPad line. The software and hardware are amazing to work with, but the most exciting developments are the baby steps we're seeing towards repairability. Whether that's due to right-to-repair legislation or the many good people at Apple that are working towards a repairable ecosystem, we don't know, but probably a bit of both. What's important though are the tangible changes that allow consumers to reduce their carbon footprint.